fucking Transformers, robots from the planet Cybertron and shit, Autobots versus Decepticons, fucking shit up. Why the hell is it so awesome? It all started with a toy, a robot that transforms into a vehicle. That alone is awesome enough, but then there were the comics and the animated TV show that began in 1984. It was one of the first shows I ever watched. As an impressionable young kid, it blew my mind. But looking back, it's still just as awesome. While a lot of cartoon shows were real corny, Transformers always had an edge of badassness. It was the baddest of ass and remains that way. Not even a $200 million budget can capture the same appeal. So what exactly was so awesome about the original show and the ass-kicking theatrical movie that came with it? I don't know. It's beyond anyone's comprehension. Let's take a look at my best remembered Transformers Generation 1 moments from the movie and the show as it aired in the US. It's Cinemassacre's top 10, nah, fuck it, 15 awesome Transformers moments.
No matter how many times I see it, it's always outrageous.
Number 15, the narrator.
In the next episode of the Transformers, the Autobots create an astonishing illusion to trap the treacherous Decepticon.
That voice sounds like he should be narrating a Grindhouse trailer.
Rocket back to Cybertron with enough energy to rule the universe, all in the third and final part of the Transformers.
It's fucking awesome! The moment you first heard those recaps, were you able to keep up? No. No kid was paying attention to the plot. Energon, Cybertron, Megatron, it all hits your brain so hard you don't even have time to think about it. You were too busy screaming for mercy as your balls were blown off by awesomeness!
The Transformers will return after these messages.
Number 14. The introduction of the Dinobots. Holy shit, they've really done it now. They combined robots with dinosaurs. They were the two most amazing things to any kid. The math is simple. Robots plus dinosaurs equals hot damn. To realize that doesn't even take half as much intelligence as Grimlock.
Make Grimlock laugh!
Number 13. All the trash talking. That's right, all the moments when the Transformers insult each other.
You're an idiot, Starscream!
You'll never catch us, Megaklutz!
Megaklutz, you dare to insult me in my own command post?
For a bunch of robots, they talk a lot of shit.
Silence, you ignorant idiot!
Us kids at the time sure got a lesson in vocabulary.
Hey, come back! You didn't finish your nickel-plated knuckle sandwich!
Number 12. Trypticon. The Decepticon's main base that transforms into a giant dinosaur robot. Basically, it's like Mechagodzilla. How rad is that? Trypticon was first introduced in the Japan-only episode, Scramble City, which came in between Season 2 and the movie, appearing at the cliffhanger. An unresolved cliffhanger, by the way. There was never a part two. But anyway, as the series progressed in true kaiju style, Trypticon attacks major cities of the world and smashes the Autobots' base. The best Trypticon moment of all is when he goes to war with Metroplex, the Autobot city that transforms into a giant robot. Oh yeah. Number 11. The Universal Monsters. Yes, that's right. The classic Universal Monsters are in Transformers. I don't know how it happened, but it did. And it's awesome. Number 10. The Touch.
You got the touch!
Yeah, Transformers has got the touch.
You got the power!
One of the things that made the movie so great was all the power rock to get you hyped up. I remember seeing the Stan Bush music video on TV as I relived all the highlights from the movie theater in my own living room. Of all my 80s memories, this might have been the 80iest.
You
The whole movie was scored by hard rock and metal tunes that matched perfectly with the action-packed animation on screen and captured the spirit and energy of everything that was Transformers. The only thing that could have made it any better was if it had Megadeth.
Well, rest in peace, Prime!
Number 9. Omega Supreme. Oh yeah, Omega motherfucking Supreme. This is one of the largest Autobots there is. So big that all the Autobots can fit inside him. He transforms from a rocket with a rocket base and a tank. And every component seems to miraculously follow wherever the rocket goes. I'm not kidding. The rocket will launch from one planet to the next, and then somehow all the other parts are sitting there waiting for him. It doesn't make any sense. My favorite thing about Omega Supreme is that he can get unruly.
Enemies, enemies, die.
He's just a big oaf. He has feelings of revenge against the Decepticons, and not even Leader Optimus Prime can get him under control.
What happened between you and the Constructicons, Omega?
Question irrelevant. Answer private.
Being so large and emotionally unstable is a pretty scary combination. Number 8. Giant Combo Robots. It all started with Season 1's last produced episode, Heavy Metal War, when the new team of Decepticons were introduced, the Constructicons. Not only do they transform into construction work vehicles, but they all form together to make one giant robot, Devastator.
Prepare for extermination!
Devastator is the most well-known of these type of robots. I've always remembered him from the movie, but he was only one of many combiners. There's the Combaticons that form Bruticus.
Bruticus hates Cybertron! Bruticus hates you more!
The Protectobots that form Defensor. The Aerialbots that form Superion. The Predacons that form Predaking, the Terracons that form Abominus, the Technobots that form Computron, and the Stunticons that form Menasor, just like Megazord from Power Rangers. That sure is a copycat right there. Didn't all this shit start with Voltron? Everything's gotta be about giant robots that come together. It's a tradition. If you want the whole thing in a nutshell, just look at the Japanese Scramble City episode. The whole episode is nothing but giant robots coming together. Basically, what it comes down to is that Japan is obsessed with these giant combiner robots. They can't get enough of this shit, and that's because Japan knows the true meaning of the word awesome. It's so awesome that when Devastator was given his chance for a new generation in Transformers Revenge of the Fallen, this whole genre of combiner robots was represented by a pile of trash. Not as awesome. Number 7. The Death of Optimus Prime. Okay, Optimus Prime. The hero, leader of the Autobots, the main character, the voice of all reason, Peter goddamn Cullen, the voice of our childhood.
One shall stand, one shall fall.
In the most shocking moment from the movie, right after the most brutal fight scene with Megatron, Optimus Prime dies.
Prime, you can't die?
But hang on, what killed him? A few laser blasts? In the TV series, he survived much worse. Prime dies almost all the time. In the episode City of Steel, his body parts are scattered all over when Megatron rebuilds New York City into New Cybertron. If he could come back from that, then what the hell? Not to mention, Ultra Magnus was also killed in the movie. Blown to pieces! But the Junkions put him back together. Why couldn't they do the same to Prime? But anyway, they somehow really sold this scene and played on our emotions.
And used the power of the Matrix to light our darkest hour.
They drag it out and savor every last dying moment. It caused a major fuss with children. Kids were taken out of the theater crying. There were even stories about kids locking themselves in their rooms. How did they have the nerve to kill off such a beloved character? That's what made it so awesome. Six, the five-part Five Faces of Darkness episodes. Season 3 picked up right where the movie left off.
But while the Autobots celebrate their victory with their new leader, Rodimus Prime, the surviving Decepticons have retreated to the burned-out planet of Char.
All the characters who died were still dead. As a kid, I just figured Optimus Prime would come right back, but this only confirmed that he and all the others were truly gone. The new leader, Rodimus Prime, and all the other new characters were here to stay and sell a new line of toys. One of the things I thought was really cool was seeing Unicron's head still floating in orbit. No continuity from the movie was being ignored. We also learned more of the Quintessons, who were responsible for creating all the Transformers and now want to destroy them. I can't really explain why the season starter is so awesome. It just had a darker tone. It was set in a post-war universe, and all around just gave us a new, fresh take on the series. But my favorite thing of all here is the new Decepticon leader, the new incarnation of Megatron, which is, of course, Galvatron. In the movie, he was voiced by Leonard Nimoy, but on the show, it was Frank Welker. He acts with no rhyme or reason, clobbering his own Decepticon followers. He beats the shit out of them. And he loves horrible sounds.
This is blowing out my audio sensors! It's torture!
No, it's music! The symphony of destruction and the anthem of agony!
In short, Galvatron is a nut. And that's what makes him an even more unstable and terrifying villain than Megatron ever was. Number 5, Web World. I don't know what's more insane, Galvatron or this episode itself.
You! Where are the Autobots?
The whole episode revolves around Galvatron's insanity.
He is crazy.
Here he's taken to a weird asylum planet where he's treated by alien therapists. Does that sound weird? Well, guess what? It is.
Just say whatever comes to mind.
Kill, smash, destroy.
Tell me where to find the Autobots, huh?
Mommy!
What were they smoking?
I have no head.
Number 4. Zombie Prime. In the episode Dark Awakening, the Quintessons resurrect Optimus Prime as a fucking zombie to lure the Autobots into a trap. It's bittersweet. Prime is back, but he's not himself at all. He attacks his fellow Autobots and fights against Rodimus Prime. This is where it gets really good. Anyone who didn't like when Rodimus took over now gets to see Optimus kick his ass.
You should have finished me.
At the end, Optimus commits suicide. He dies again.
Until all are one.
This show had serious balls.
Goodbye, old friend.
Daniel cries again. That poor kid must be traumatized, just like all the other kids watching this. Number 3. Megatron turns into Galvatron. From the movie, a beaten, broken Megatron and his henchmen are left for dead by Starscream, floating out into space until they meet Unicron, the giant planet-eating planet voiced by Orson Welles in his final role.
Welcome, Megatron.
This mammoth of terror turns Megatron and company into a new set of Decepticons. Why is it so awesome? Just look at it. Whoa. Dude.
Behold, Galvatron.
The only thing more awesome was seeing it on the big screen in the theater in 1986. I've been in a trance ever since. Number two, The Return of Optimus Prime. Hands down, the biggest moment of all in the original TV series, the one I distinctly remember best as the biggest television event of my youth, was when Optimus Prime came back for good in this two-part extravaganza.
Our leader is back.
Yes, Skylinks. And this time, no force in the universe can stop me.
A deadly plague is sweeping across the galaxy that affects every living creature, including humans and Transformers. It makes everybody go berserk and attack one another. It's now Autobots against Autobots and Decepticons against Decepticons. All hell is breaking loose. The only one who can save the galaxy is Optimus Prime. After his body is retrieved, the Autobots enlist the Quintessons to revive him. Even they have no choice in order to save the whole galaxy.
Transform and roll out!
But it doesn't stop there. Prime needs the Autobot Matrix of Leadership, which is now inside Rodimus. So he has to coat himself in a special heat-resistant metal to fight against his old buddy.
I don't want to hurt you, Rodimus!
If that's not already awesome enough, we get to hear the touch one more time.
You got the power!
Now light our darkest hour.
And now for the number one most awesome moment in the history of Transformers ever. Unicron transforms from the movie. Unicron was already awesome enough as the Eater of Worlds, devouring every possible thing in his path. So awesome, in fact, that he inspired the only S-bomb in the entire series.
Oh shit, what are we gonna do now?
How could this get any more awesome?
You underestimate me, Galvatron.
Well, at the end of the movie, we find out that Unicron is also a Transformer. Oh my god. As a kid, I didn't see this coming. The buildup was incredible. And now in humanoid form with wings and horns, he looks just like the fucking devil himself. No! The most evil and deadliest villain of all. There isn't even a point of him transforming. Why does he have legs? He's so big, there's nothing in space for him to stand on. That is what you call the epitome of awesome.